Mick was born in Brooklyn, New York. I'm a New Yorker, so yay. He is a film critic for the San Francisco Chronicle, where he has worked since 1985. He's the author of two books on pre-censorship Hollywood. The first is called Complicated Women, Sex and Power in Pre-Code Hollywood, and also Dangerous Men, Pre-Code Hollywood and the Birth of the Modern Man. Both were books of the month on Turner Classic Movies, and Complicated Women formed the basis of a Turner Classic Movie documentary in 2003, narrated by Jane Fonda. He has written introductions for a number of books, including Peter Cowie's Joan Crawford, The Enduring Star. He was a panelist at the Berlin Film Festival and has served as a panelist for 8 of the last 10 years at the Venice Film Festival. His latest book, and I have all 3 of them up here, borrowed, of course, from the library because that is what I do, is a study of women in French cinema, and it is called The Beauty of the Real, What Hollywood Can Learn from Contemporary French Actresses. Please welcome Mick LaSalle. Welcome, Mick.
Yeah, thank you. It's good to be here.
And thank you for coming to Stockton, and thank you all for giving him a warm Stockton welcome.
This is my first, I've been in California for 33 years, this is my first visit to Stockton.
All right.
So, yeah, it's very nice. It looks great.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hopefully it won't be your last.
No, I hope not.
So I think most of us are first kind of just a little curious about you.
Yeah.
So can you tell us a little bit about your background, where you grew up, and were films a big part of your childhood?
Background, I grew up, I was born in Brooklyn, but my family moved to Staten Island when I was 6. I would say I don't think films are a big part of my childhood, but my father was very into movies, and so through him, I wound up with a decent grounding in classic film because he knew who everybody was. He liked somewhat different movies. He kind of liked action adventure movies more than I did, and I like more like romantic kind of movies, my father had one interesting characteristic. He had a photographic memory from movies, so that if he saw a movie 30 years ago, he could tell you every scene in the movie. I never met anybody. As a result, it was kind of boring because he would look for opportunities to tell entire movies because he had them in his head. And so I would always try to, like, when I would see the conversation going in that direction, I would try to just change the subject really fast. But there was one time I remember he was telling me about a Richard Barthelmess movie from 1933 that he had seen 30 years earlier. And as he's telling me, it took about 3 or 4 minutes for me to realize that I had seen the same movie about 8 months before. Didn't remember it at all, and he remembered everything. So, but anyhow, that's my background. It was I didn't have a big background in movies, but I definitely knew who Humphrey Bogart was and things like that. Yeah.
So, this you might have answered a little bit of my next question. Are there any films either from your youth or so? What was the first film that kind of maybe had a profound impact on you?
I was very interested as a child, I was very interested in American history. I was really interested in American history, and I, in a way, I still am. And politics and the presidency and things like that. And so the movie that was my favorite movie for a long time was Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, mm-hmm. which I saw when I was about 9 or 10 years old, and just loved it. And would watch it every time it was on.
So how did your interest in film evolve into a career as a critic?
I mean, in a way, coincidentally and accidentally, I became interested in movies in a deeper way when I was in college and then graduate school. Because I started getting interested in older movies, and would read about classic movies, but it wasn't anything I was going to have anything to do with. It was just it was like being into, you know, Led Zeppelin or something. It was just something that I was interested in, and I wound up becoming a film critic just because I was in when I was in graduate school, I started writing for the school newspaper. But I did very few movie reviews, maybe two or three, if that. I was really just I was a columnist, and I would write about things that were going on. But the Chronicle hired me on the basis of those clips from my school newspaper. It helps. You know, it was the mid '80s. It was a healthy economy, so you can have like an extra person, and. So I was hired. And then once I was at the Chronicle, the job that I really wanted was to be the film critic. I really wanted that job. And other people had that job, but I just eventually just kind of slipped in there. Nobody really cared. I mean, Peter Stack, you know, was one of the film critics there, but he was pretty laid back, and he didn't care. And if I wanted to do the work, you know. And Judy Stone was there, but she didn't want to see any movies that didn't have subtitles. She only wanted to see foreign films. And so I started doing, you know, they started me on horror movies, and then I graduated fairly quickly to, you know, big releases, and you know, became the de facto main critic after about 2.5 years of arriving there, I guess.
So. This is a question we hadn't talked about this, but it's something that crossed my mind. So the Chronicle uses a very creative way of what you do in terms of how good the movie is. So the guy who's asleep in his chair from him jumping out of his chair. So do you know how that system came about?
No, I don't, except that I know that it was around from the 30s or late 30s or early 40s. So it's something that was around for a while, and it may have had its origins actually in another publication that was a minor publication, and then somebody at the Chronicle liked it and stole it. But the Chronicle is the only place that does it. It's our thing, and as a result, we'll never get rid of it because it is our. Yeah. It's like a signature for the paper. Yeah. Not just for the section, but for the paper itself. Yeah.
So these days, I'm not aware whether there are more films coming out than before, but do you go to the theater to see all the films that you review?
No, I go to the theater. I see movies in one of four ways. I either see an evening screening of a movie that is with a big audience of people who won tickets on over the radio, or I see it in a screening room with other critics, or I see it on DVD, or actually now they even have it on a computer. You can see a movie on a computer. For the big movies, they screen the big movies. So if it's a movie that's one of the big movies of the week, I did see it in the theater. I used to really dislike daytime screenings up until about 2 years ago, which were always with critics, and always preferred to just be with big audiences in the evening, because I would always say that writing, the day is for writing and the evening is for going to the movies. But in the last couple of years, I'm beginning to like daytime screenings. I'm beginning to just not like going out at night as much. Mm-hmm. It took me just until about 2 years ago, but now I kind of just prefer to get it all over with during the day.
Mm-hmm. So I'm guessing here, but if something is a big release, are you pretty much obligated to see it and review it? Or do you
Yes.
have, what discretion do you have
well,
over what you can decide to pass up on if you want to?
Well, I want to. What is a desirable movie is a big story, whatever is the big story. And because it is journalism, after all, and even though it's film criticism. And so there's really no interest in seeing a completely obscure movie that will only take up 12 inches in the paper when Wonder Woman is opening, even if I'd really rather see maybe the other movie. So I want to see that movie. However, if there's a several, you know, a lot of big movies opening, and this will happen sometimes in December, or you know, things get bunched up at different times, then I'll welcome, I'll welcome a chance to miss, like say, the new Halloween movie, which Peter Hartlaub reviewed, and he's the one to do it. He likes that genre, and he did a very good job. And I think he did a better job than I would have done, because it's just he knows about it, and it's actually something that I consider a chore to see. I don't like those kind of movies. So occasionally, for a big movie like that, and there's some other kinds of genre, I never like to reveal what genres of movies I don't like, because then it invites people to say, when I dislike something, that I disliked it because I just don't like that generically. So. But there's some kinds of movies that I would avoid if I can.
Okay.
Yeah.
We won't force you to reveal your trade secrets.
Yeah.
Okay. Of course, film, the way films are made, the ability for higher level special effects and other things have really changed the viewing experience over the last 25 and probably more years. So
yes.
How do you think the viewing experience has changed over the last couple of decades?
Well, I mean, it's a lot of heavy special effects movies do, to me, look like you're looking at a blown up computer screen, which I find completely uninteresting. And to me, to say that automatically implies something bad. But I think there are people who actually like the idea of a movie looking like a big blown up computer screen. It's the way it is. But I think that's, you know, but ultimately all these technological advances, they ultimately don't matter. They matter in the moment. But if we look at the things that almost all special effects that are 30 years old look fake. But the people at the time thought looked wonderful, and I've read, you know, descriptions of scenes that people would say, oh, this was horrific, you know, like a horrific car crash scene in a movie from 1930, and you see the scene and it looks completely harmless and ridiculous. So I think that the experience has changed in terms of maybe what we see, but the experience doesn't change in terms of what we want or what we get from ideally get from the experience of seeing movies.
So I want to, there's a couple of interesting things that you've written, many interesting things, but there's a couple I've noted, and I wanted to ask maybe if you could talk a little bit more about them. So you've written that, quote, for most people, there's no difference between what they like and what they believe to be good or great.
Right.
The more they like something, the more they insist on its quality. But for a critic, it has to be different. So can you describe that responsibility further?
Maybe
talk about a critically good film that you personally dislike.
Well, sure. There are certain kinds of movies that each individual, there's certain kinds of movies that you just don't like. You don't like that kind of movie. And if you don't like that kind of movie, it doesn't serve anybody for me to write in the newspaper this, you know, ridiculous syllogism, which would be blah, blah, blah is this kind of movie. I don't like this kind of movie. Therefore, it's a bad movie. That's just useless. So I should be able to tell whether it's a good Marvel Comics movie, even if I don't particularly want to see that kind of movie, and would never see that kind of movie. You know, I mean, I would never go to see really any any comic book movie. I mean, not a single one. I wouldn't, you know, the day comes I retire, I'll never see another one for the rest of my life. But it would not only be snobbish, but it would be kind of useless to not be able to tell that Wonder Woman and Black Panther are good ones, mm-hmm. and that other ones are bad ones. So it's like that. Or a movie like, a movie that I absolutely hated, The Experience. I didn't review it. Somebody else reviewed it, and I was glad, because it's the worst thing to have to give a good review to something you didn't enjoy. Because, first of all, it's not fun to be basically, in a sense, recommending something that if you yourself didn't like it, you wouldn't want to do that. But there's also there's a reservoir of information and visceral reaction that I don't have access to, because actually I didn't like it. And it's almost like a purely intellectual process to look at something that you didn't like and say you liked it. And so, for example, a movie like Pandora's Box, the Guillermo del Toro movie, it was just a completely violent, nasty, unpleasant movie. With a horrible ending. I mean, it just horribly depressing ending. So, you know, I'm glad I didn't have to write it. Somebody else wrote it. To have written how good that movie was would not be fun. I had the not very fun experience with The Shape of Water, which I did not enjoy at all, mm-hmm. and kept on waiting. I just couldn't wait for it to be over. I couldn't wait for it to be over. But when it was, I said, well, it's a good movie. Yeah, I could tell that it's good. But it isn't. That's the least fun thing to do, is to have to do that. But I think if you don't do that, then what you're doing is the ultimate egotism and uselessness, where you're saying you're only reading this review to have an encounter with my personality and my preferences, not even my judgments, but just my gut level prejudices, almost. Mm-hmm. Not even preferences, and that would be of no use to anybody.
So it's interesting you mentioned that. I had a very similar experience in seeing The Shape of Water, and I felt, you know, amongst my film going friends who all loved it, I kept my, you know, kept quiet, because I had a similar experience of it was something about it that was entertaining, but in the end, I was surprised that it was as popular, or we'll talk about the Academy Awards in a little bit.
Okay,
and
sure.
About what they're most useful for. Mm-hmm. You also mentioned, I'm curious, because now we're talking a little bit about movies. So I think before you were saying that you felt that in terms of even though, you know, you might not ever see a Marvel movie again, but you mentioned Wonder Woman and Black Panther.
Yeah.
And you felt, you thought that those were
those are good.
Kind of above sort of.
Yeah, yeah. Because they're trying to do something a little bit different, and they're both responses to what's going on in the country. We are entering a very. People of goodwill can disagree. I think we're in a pretty lousy period of American history now. And I think as a result of that, we're in a good period for movies. And I predicted this about a year and a half ago. I don't know what happened a year and a half ago that would make me predict this. But I predicted this about a year and a half ago that movies were going to get really good. And the Depression was a great period for movies. The 70s, the late 60s, I mean, starting in like 1968, which was one of the worst years, you know, in the United States, it was horrible. Movies got really interesting, and then they stayed really interesting. Movies were not very good in the Reagan years, and they weren't very good in the Clinton years. And I used to say, when in the 90s, I was saying, you know, wow, you know, it would be nice. I wish we were in a better era for movies. Now I think, wow, I trade the movies to, you know, live in the economy of the 80s and the economy of the 90s. I mean, those years look like the halcyon period. I mean, it just really looks great. But when things get bad, movies tend to get better. And I think that I mean, Wonder Woman was made during the election and was a response that was they expected a different world, and they had in jokes about Hillary Clinton being president within Wonder Woman. But Black Panther was made when everybody knew what happened, and that was made with that in mind. And we're getting a lot of movies now that are a response. And you know, even if you don't agree with the movies politically, they're good movies anyway, so go see them. I mean, The Oath is an amazing movie that opened on Friday. Black Klansman is a terrific movie. Yep. Blind Spotting is a terrific movie. And so a lot of the movies that make the top 10 this year will definitely be movies about what's going on. And Black Panther and Wonder Woman, in their different ways, were the same thing. They were trying to use the Marvel thing for a bigger purpose. Mm-hmm. And so I thought that was interesting, and I liked it. The things about both those movies I'm not crazy about, but that's just I just generically don't like those movies. But still, I thought they were, for the kind of movie they were very good.
So now we're going to talk a little bit about the Academy Awards. And in several of your columns, you actually mentioned the fact that the Oscars have never been about acknowledging enduring excellence, and in fact have stood in opposition to that idea. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Well, I mean, first off, Best Picture has always been bad until like maybe the last 10 years. And now they're thinking of changing the rules again so maybe bad movies could start winning Best Picture again. But, you know, it's five movies, and usually the movie that won up until 2008 would be the biggest movie, hired the most people, and the worst of the movies. And then the acting categories, they had different problems. Acting categories, people tend never to award someone for playing anything like themselves. They instead tend to award people for doing a complete physical transformation. And so they'll give it to people who are playing somebody who's really sick, or they'll give it to somebody who's playing a historical character and imitating them properly. And sometimes these performances are great and deserve Academy Awards anyway, like Capote, I thought was pretty great. Although, I have to say, Heath Ledger in Brokeback Mountain, you know, that's pretty good too. I thought Gary Oldman was absolutely amazing as Winston Churchill for a whole bunch of reasons. But it is true that after 20 or 30 years pass, nobody really cares about the person, the imitative performances or the uncharacteristic performances or the chameleonic performances. They tend to like the performances when people are kind of being themselves, but inhabiting a character. Because with the passage of time, you realize that those movies where the people are being themselves actually have value beyond the individual personality. So like, for example, Humphrey Bogart in Casablanca, you know, oh yeah, okay, it's Humphrey Bogart being like Humphrey Bogart, but it's also him embodying a kind of mentality, a kind of a philosophical moment. He lost that year, but he won for The African Queen. I don't think that's that great, The African Queen. I think it's okay, but that's not really why you go see Humphrey Bogart. George Clooney has been nominated 3 times for movies that he should have won for. Michael Clayton, he was absolutely amazing. Yes. I think he lost. Yes. He lost. I didn't make the movie. Don't worry about it. I think he was nominated for either for that or for Up in the Air. He was nominated against Daniel Day-Lewis for There Will Be Blood. And people are very impressed by that kind of thing in the moment. Mm-hmm. But 20, 30 years from now, people will be looking at George Clooney when they want to get an idea of what it was to be a man at the turn of the century, the turn of the millennium.
Yes.
And they're not going to be looking at There Will Be Blood for anything. That's not going to mean anything to them. It'll be of no importance to them at all. They might like Lincoln, though, because it's just because Lincoln will always be
right.
important, and it was a great performance.
Yes.
But There Will Be Blood, that's not going to be doing anything. So the Academy basically enshrines the artistic preconceptions of the moment. The other thing, too, is let's say, you know, it's voted by one's peers, right? So you're voting, let's say you're voting for your peers. Well, if somebody put on a lot of makeup and changed their voice and became Truman Capote, you could maybe say to yourself that if you put on a lot of makeup and you changed your voice, you could be Truman Capote. But on the other hand, if you're voting and it's you're voting for best actor, you know you can't do George Clooney. You know you can't do Betty Davis. You just can't, you can't do that stuff. Mm-hmm. Because that's only them. So it kind of hurts a little to vote for somebody who could do something wonderful that you can't do. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't hurt so much, because even if you can't be Capote, you know that you could be somebody else. And you could put on the makeup so you can have that thing happen to you. So I think there's that too. And as a result, continually the wrong things win. However, the Academy has value in enshrining the artistic ideas of the moment, mm-hmm. what people thought were important at the time.
So I'm just curious about, speaking of kind of Academy moments, where were you, and what was your reaction with the whole La La Land Moonlight?
Oh, that was funny. That was funny. It's a different reaction than anybody else would have, because of the peculiar thing I'm doing on Academy Awards. I am writing the story. I'm writing the article, and so we always get happy. We find out who won Best Director. Mm-hmm. Because then we know, and I'm writing the article. The article is due 20 minutes after the award's over. So basically, I'm writing it from the bottom up. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I write the paragraphs about the supporting categories, and I put them there, and I just keep on stacking things. And, you know, I try different things out. I'll say, the blah, blah, blah juggernaut took over, you know, and I just guess. And then sometimes, you know, because sometimes during commercials, I just write different versions of things that might happen. And so I saw that La La Land won, and then I just plugged in my La La Land paragraph, which I think may have been pre-written, and then started tailoring it to the fact that it also won Best Actress and doing all this stuff. But I stayed in the room with the TV set. I had the sound off. And then I noticed that there was a commotion there. And then my phone rang, and it was my editor. And she said, you know, do you have the TV on? I said, hold on. And so then I said, okay, well, this is actually good, because because it was a boring story. So I was able to do that. But so for me, it was just a writing problem. What I used to do, by the way, to the Academy Awards is because we were very big on blogs a few years ago. We're not that so much anymore at the Chronicle, but we're very big on blogs. So what I would do is I would write paragraphs, versions of history that could happen. Mm-hmm. You know, usually there's like three people who could win in each category. I'd write a paragraph for each one. And then on the blog, I'd put all the paragraphs of the losers. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
But so, now when you realized that Moonlight had actually won, had there been a film that you felt, your personal favorite for that category? Were you happy about Moonlight? They're two very different films, clearly.
Yeah. I guess of the two, it's close. I gave them both the highest ratings. I think I might have liked La La Land better. Mm-hmm. I mean La La Land is easier to watch. You know, but I didn't really care one way or the other. Mm-hmm. Neither was my favorite movie of the year, so it didn't much matter.
Do you recall which one was?
I don't.
Was it Wonder Woman?
No. No, it was that was the year, was it? Yeah. It might have been.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. If I had a list, you know, they kind of flow in, one flows into the next. It's like if you're a school teacher, you don't remember what, you know, you remember students, but not what class the students were in. You know.
Very good. So another Academy Award change you mentioned in one of the columns is that in 2009, they changed the way they pick Best Picture, and it led to some immediate differences. Yeah. So what was that change, and what were some of the results?
They started doing this thing, ranked voting, and I don't understand it exactly, but they count up the first place winners, and then I think if nobody has a majority, then they start counting the second place winners, the second place choices, and if nobody has a majority, they go to the third. And so what this does is the bad thing it kind of does is it can penalize front runners, because if you have a movie that you absolutely don't want to see win, you can make sure you make that eighth or ninth so that it'll never be counted. Mm-hmm. But it also, though, prevents a situation of any movie winning with 21% of the vote, which is conceivable. If everybody gets 19 or 20, you can win in a five-way race with 21%, which is, you know, it's a very bad plurality rather than a majority. So with the ranked voting, you can't win without some form of majority. And that's good, because it's good for smaller movies. Because if you've hired 1,000 people to work on a film, and everybody's going to vote for it, that gets you a lot closer to 21%. I mean, I don't know how many members of the Academy there are, but I don't think it's more than 3,600 or 4,000 or something like that. So, I mean, I'm not 100% sure of that, but it's not that many people. So if even like 500 people worked on a movie and they all vote for it, so this protects the smaller movies, and as a result, you see things like... the first example was that Avatar was almost certainly going to win in the old voting system, but instead it was the Catherine Bigelow movie about Afghanistan.
The Hurt Locker.
Yeah, so the Hurt Locker won instead, and Avatar absolutely would have won in the, and it would have taken its place among the typical things that do win Best Picture, which is the technological advances. And being big and being a little bit stupid.
Agreed. Although I will say, for me, seeing Avatar, that was a truly incredible visual experience.
Yeah.
The story, very kind of, in my opinion, very stereotypical. When I heard that the mineral was called unobtainium was when I kind of got lost, but still enjoyed seeing all the effects.
Yeah, I didn't review it, I knew it was one of those movies I had to see, but I kept on looking for excuses to get up and walk around. because I found it painful to sit there and watch it. I'm not terribly interested in. If I don't really see human faces in a movie, I kind of zone out.
Is you find it more challenging to see animated films?
A little bit, although animated films lately are a little bit more facially detailed. People get so mad at me when I say things like that. They do. But some of the Pixar movies in the last 10 years, they're really good. So, generally speaking, that at least was a little bit of a stumbling block for me.
Okay.
Yeah.
But what about the Japanese filmmaker like Princess Mononoke and...
That's the kind of animation I just don't like.
Okay.
Yeah, and
you know, you are giving away sort of some of your categories.
Yeah, but that I would. There's so few of those movies that I would have somebody else do that.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's the kind of it's very rigid, and it's same thing like Little Mermaid, that kind of thing. Wow. I don't like watching that. Or I think there's a Pocahontas movie, wasn't there?
Yes, there was.
Yeah, I didn't like
Disney
that.
Ones, yeah.
No, I just don't like watching that. But mm-hmm. but the Toy Story movies, Up, even Cars, the Cars are kind of expressive. I'd say in the 21st century, I changed. Mm-hmm. But yeah, the 80s, 90s, and then the anime I'm not crazy about. Okay.
Are there any film awards, so aside from the Oscars, or in place of the Oscars, that you think are more successful at acknowledging enduring excellence in filmmaking?
I mean, in the broad sweep of history, mm-hmm. you know, not every time, I think that the best award, as far as historically speaking, is probably the New York Film Critics Award.
Okay.
Yeah, I think historically speaking. I mean, you know, they gave it to Greta Garbo for Camille. As the Academy gave it to Louise Reiner for The Good Earth. Mm. You know, things like that. I mean, they've been, historically, they're the best.
And that doesn't sound like it's a large group. If it's just, is it just literally New York?
Yeah, New York Film Critics. Yeah, but yeah, but that's a you know, that's a good body of film critics. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's and they see everything. They see, you know, because everything goes to New York.
Yes, I remember when I was there. are there any films that you've reviewed where you were in the minority among critics in your opinion?
Oh, well, that happens all the time.
And did you catch any flack for that, or flack from others about your reviews?
Well, I mean, the worst is when I'm alone. I'm completely alone. I'm so alone that I make the national ad that goes everywhere. And then people make fun of me. Like, there was some Steven Seagal movie that I said was great. But no, I don't get any, nobody says anything. Certainly nobody I work with. But anyway, I get happy. My reviews appear the same time everybody else's. Mm-hmm. And most of the time I have no idea what other people are going to think. But when I look on Rotten Tomatoes and I see that most people disagree with me, I get happy. I prefer it. When I was in Venice and I saw A Star Is Born, and I saw it in a theater in Venice with the Venetian public, okay, as opposed to at the film festival. So if I saw it at the film festival, I would have been able to figure out whether people would like the movie or not. Mm-hmm. Because when you see it in a film festival, the people in the audience, they do this at Cannes as well, although I've never been to Cannes, but they are very vocal about whether the movie was good or not because they want to influence perception. But I saw it just at a regular theater in with Venetians, and I thought when I saw Star Is Born, I'm the only one who's going to like this movie. Mm. I thought everybody will make fun of this movie and I'll be alone saying that it's good. And in that case, I was very happy to find out that people did agree with me because I wanted to see that movie, you know, succeed. But it doesn't faze me one way or the other if I'm alone or mm-hmm. or, and in a vague sort of way, it kind of pleases me. it only displeases me when I worry about the movie, like when I see like some great movie. If I like something and everybody hates it, that might bother me than if I don't like something and everybody loves it. Mm-hmm. Because if I like something and everybody hates it, those people who hated it will ruin its financial prospects. Uh-huh. And that, you know, so right. that I don't want to see that. Just for the vanity of being the only one who's right. It's not worth it.
So we're gonna in a few minutes, I have a couple more questions, but in a few minutes we also have a few clips we're gonna show.
Oh, nice. Okay.
That you had recommended sort of about kind of worst and some of your worst, your favorites and your least favorites.
Okay.
So I'm not gonna get through all my questions, so I'm gonna kind of skim for the juicy ones here. So I do want to talk a little bit also about your books.
Okay.
So you've written two on pre-code Hollywood,
yep.
Complicated Women and Dangerous Men. I want to talk about those first. So can you tell for our folks gathered here kind of what was that era for those that don't understand or know what it was, and what is it about that era that interested you enough to write two books on it?
Yeah. Okay. So. A lot of you are familiar with old movies and the kind of things that you can see in old movies. The movies made between 1929 and June 1st, 1934, didn't have to play by those same rules, and they were able to be much more adult and show aspects of life that you couldn't show. So the movies were able to be political, and the movies also were able to be risque. And it was a great era for women, and it was coming off of a breakthrough era for women, because the 20s were very transformative in women's lives, in the lives of American women. I mean, there were so many things that women could do that they couldn't do before. And at the dresses got shorter, they started going to college more, they started getting to the workplace more, they were in charge of their own bodies, in the sense that contraception was available to women. And what I mean by that is, it wasn't just the condom, that women had the diaphragm starting at around 1925. That's kind of important. I mean, Norma Shearer goes on a sexual rampage through Europe in the movie Strangers May Kiss, 1931. I mean, you know, she would not be able to go on a sexual rampage if she didn't have her own contraception. Can't depend on all those European guys to do the right thing. And so it was this breakthrough period, and the movies reflected that. And then movies started getting really, I mean, really risque. It's also very interesting, too, in the beginning of the era, they started making a lot of movies about prostitutes and a lot of movies about crooks. So the men's movies a lot about crooks and women's movies about prostitutes. And those movies kind of disappeared by the end of the pre-code era. And the reason was is that the prostitute movies really weren't about prostitution. They were really about women's sexual liberation, and they were starting off by making movies about the fringes of society and then testing that, because the prostitutes were always sympathetic. Always, 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 always. And then eventually they just started being able to make movies about women with sex lives who weren't married. And the crooks, they were guys who were, you know, responding to inequities in the world, you know, the not just to the Great Depression, but also, you know, to people were very upset about prohibition. I mean, we take it for granted that it went, but they didn't know. They didn't know it was going away. And cops would be, you know, barging, Coast Guard would go on somebody's boat, killing people, and then finding like one bottle of something. It's just like so many bad things were happening. And so people were sympathetic to the criminal. And then, so then that was the birth of the shady hero. So it's a very interesting period, and you can see things if you're not familiar with pre-code movies, it's a revelation. And the revelation, I mean, the revelation for women, it's a real revelation, because you get to see that actually that women were normal, because you couldn't show the normalness of women post 1934. It had to be all a little bit phony, and women were always, you know, either sacrificial or evil. I mean, that's why film noir, you know, came back, is because you had, if you're making a movie about, you want to show, you're making a movie with a beautiful woman, right? Actresses, you know, Hollywood, they tend to be nice looking. So you want to make a movie about a beautiful woman. You also want to make a movie about sexuality. Okay, you can't really do that if she's nice. So she has to be evil. And so there you get film noir. You know, and it's the return of the evil woman. There were evil women in a lot of movies from like 1920. So women's stories were so interesting. You had it was like the British invasion. It was like all of a sudden they weren't British. I mean, you have all these tons of young talents who would then be making movies for the next 20, 30 years. I mean, you know, Greta Garbo, Katharine Hepburn, Betty Davis, Barbara Stanwyck, Miriam Hopkins, I mean, on and on and on. It's really, we're talking about like 30 people who are, Loretta Young, people making, Norma Shearer, of course, making three or four movies a year. It's an amazing period. And I came along after the generation of film critics that basically decided what the basic repertory was of film. And they were able to do that because film books were popular. And then with the coming of VHS, people stopped buying film books because you could buy the book, buy the movie. And as a result, the conversation about what the repertory is, about what really are the great American films, stopped as a public debate. And so it took me four and a half years to get this book published. Four and a half years, and you'd think I'd be connected, right? I'd be able to say to publishers, "Hey, look, you know, I write for a newspaper. I'm not completely unknown." And not only that, Turner Classic Movies said they wanted to make a documentary based on the book. If the book ever got picked up, still took me four and a half years. But to me, it was just very important, and I took it very seriously. And then the book about the men, I'm rather proud of as well. That book is really about business and politics and things like that. I would say that my first book was a book of advocacy, and my second book was more of a book of scholarship. And so take your pick which you like better.
So I want to save a little time. Can we talk a little bit about your third book before we show some
clips? Yeah, real quick then. My third book, I was thinking about doing another book about women in film, and I thought maybe after censorship went away, it was a great explosion of women's roles. No, 70s were a disaster for women, just a few good roles. Everybody says, oh, how about Clute? How about Alice doesn't live here anymore? How about Jill Clairberg and an Unmarried Woman? And I say, yeah, okay, what's the fourth one? It's really not a good era for women. And then I got interested in French movies, and I started noticing that it was the exact same thing that was going on in the early 30s in the United States was happening in France, that there was these amazing actresses making three or four movies a year or two or three movies a year who were in movies built around their personalities as they were in the Hollywood years, and they were the kinds of movies that people say that they wish they could see, that they wish Americans could see. And I wanted to say to people, The Barbara Stanwycks and the Garbos and the people like that are just French now, and we should just watch these movies. I was also hoping that the book would be picked up in France and that I would actually make some money. That didn't happen. Unfortunately, it didn't happen. This book has sold so few copies, I could have just saved time and just gone over everybody's house who bought the book and talked to them for 10 minutes. And it would have been the same thing.
Let me just plug this though for you. I mean, all three of these are very, that was my feeling, honestly.
Yeah,
they're all really excellent. But I have a tangential kind of knowledge of French film. I have friends who are interested in French cinema, and I know a lot of the names in here. But I realized in my reading of the book how little I had seen, and how many great women actresses there are, especially in France. So it's a really interesting book. So I highly recommend it, as I do the other other two books. Yeah. But I want to spend a few more minutes showing now some movie clips of films that you we asked Mick ahead of time. Tell us some films that you think are really great films or ones that are really crappy films. I didn't use that term, but you get the idea. And so he gave us a wide range. We in the interest of time, we chose two of the films you really liked and think are great, and then two of the ones that you had a low opinion of.
Okay.
So are we going to show the ones that you really liked first? Okay.
Okay. That's
so I think, so this is the first one, Romeo and Juliet. Zeffirelli's Romeo and Juliet from 1968. Okay.
Oh, Romeo, Romeo. Wherefore art thou, Romeo? Deny thy father and refuse thy name. Or if thou wilt not, be but sworn my love, and I'll no longer be a Capulet.
Shall I hear more, or shall I speak?
Tis but thy name that is my enemy. Thou art thyself, though, not a Montague. What is Montague? It is nor hand, nor foot, nor arm, nor face, nor any other part belonging to a man. Oh, be some other name. What's in a name? That which we call a rose. By any other name would smell as sweet. So Romeo would, were he not Romeo called, retain that dear perfection which he owes without that title. Romeo, doff thy name, and for that name which is no part of thee, take all myself.
Gone are my blues, and gone are my tears. I've got good news to shout in your ears. The long-lost dollar has come back to the fold. With silver you can turn your dreams to gold. We're in the money, we've got a lot of what it takes to get along. We're in the money, the sky is sunny. Old man depression, you are through, you done us wrong. Oh, we never see headline about red line today. And when we see the landlord, we can look that guy right in the eye. Oh, we're in the money, come on, my honey. Let's lend it, spend it, send it, rolling around.
So those are the two Mick's top lists. Gold Diggers of 1933 was that last clip, and the 1968 Zeffirelli version of Romeo and Juliet.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about why you chose those.
Well, there are two favorite movies of mine. It's just really weird, the internal nature of movies. It's kind of weird. It's that movie, I didn't see that movie until Romeo and Juliet until 1973. And I go back, it's a double thing going on. I go back to being 14 and being in love with Olivia Hussey. You know, she still looks good to me. I'm pushing 60 now. but at the same time, I also feel a kind of like paternal thing, you know. The movies stay the same and we get older, and it's like this mix of things. So it's like I watch it simultaneously at 14 and 59. Mm-hmm. Strange. And then Gold Diggers of 33, it's a great pre-code movie. It's a movie that actually combines two of the nice things about the pre-code era. It's a pretty risque movie, not very, but it has that element. And then at the same time, it's pretty political. Mm-hmm. And the whole last 5 minutes is like a commentary on what Hoover did to the Bonus Army, if you know about the Bonus Army, which was a very safe commentary because Roosevelt was already president. Mm-hmm. It's very easy to go after the president who's not there anymore. But so that and it's a movie with just a great spirit to it, and I really love it. I would say that those are movies that are, you know, my top 10 favorite movies. I probably have 25 movies in my top 10, but those would really be in my top 10, the real actual top 10. Yeah.
The real top 10.
The real top 10.
So let's take another couple minutes and we'll show some that are not in your, that are probably your bottom 10 or not on your list.
Okay.
Pirates of the Caribbean 2.
Oh boy, that's bad.
And then, what's the other one?
Did you find the clip?
We found one of them, yes.
That clip?
I don't know if it's that clip. So for those of you, we'll just warn you ahead of time. This is a clip with our current president.
That's the one.
Will you sail to the ends of the earth and beyond to fetch back Witty Jack? An precious pearl.
I.
Yes.
All right. But if you go and brave the weird and haunted shores at world's end, then you will need a captain who knows those waters.
So tell me, what's become of my ship?
Did I win? I did, didn't I?
You were good.
I read your book. And I won, I did. I beat you.
You were very good. You played the situation perfectly.
So I beat the situation, but not you.
That's what you did.
I think you like to make mischief.
You noticed that too.
Yeah, we're Mike is live, so we can hear all the sound effects. What was the name again?
Ghosts Can't Do
Ghosts
It.
Ghosts Can't Do It's It. So tell us about the
Ghosts Can't Do It. I mean, the thing that's bad about the movie is not... I mean, Donald Trump doesn't help the movie. But he's not what's wrong with the movie. Although I think he got a bad review in the Chronicle when I reviewed it, because he kept on making this like kind of fish face at the end of every line. Not in this scene, but in the previous scene. And so I did notice that. But no, this movie's just terrible. It's a movie called Ghosts Can't Do It, and it's with Anthony Quinn and Bo Derek. And it's a, Anthony Quinn is married to Bo Derek, and he dies, but before he dies, she makes him promise to come back and take over somebody, a younger person's body, so that he could then do it. So he then takes over like a young guy's body, and she starts having sex with that guy. You know, it's funny. Seeing Bo Derek reminds me, we did a documentary about complicated women, and that Jane Fonda eventually narrated, which was great. I mean, it was great, and to, you know, to have Jane Fonda in the sound booth and to be outside and hear Jane Fonda basically reciting my book was an extraordinary thing, especially with that voice that is so familiar. But before they got Jane Fonda, I got a phone call from the producers, and they said, "Good news." I said, "Yeah." I said, "We have our person. We have our person." I said, "Who?" I said, "Bo Derek is going to narrate your documentary." And I just waited. I waited for the
punchline.
Yeah, I waited for him to start laughing. I said, "You kidding me? This is a disaster. This is horrible." Anyway, so fortunately, that didn't happen, and they had Jane Fonda instead, who was perfect.
That's an upgrade, yes.
Yeah, it's a big upgrade, yeah.
So, and so talk about Pirates of the Caribbean.
Oh, I just hated. I hated every one of those movies. I hated every one of those movies. And two, I thought was the worst because it doesn't begin, it doesn't end. Everybody looks disgusting in it. I mean, everybody looks disgusting in it. And I think that, you know, it's like most of the movies are a contest between Jeffrey Rush and Johnny Depp to who could do the worst, you know, the most overdone bad performance, and they both lose. I hated that movie. I hated that movie so much. I hated the experience of it so much that my review wasn't even any good, because to really write a good pan, you have to have a little bit of distance, mm-hmm, you know. Mm-hmm. And instead, it was almost like I was like somebody, you know, sat on my cat or something. You know what I mean? It was like they did something personal to me, and I didn't have a sense of humor about it. I just really hated that movie. I hated every one of those movies, although, but degrees of hate. But that was the one that I hated the most.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I want to thank you, Mick, for spending this hour with us. Very much. Thank you, sir.
My pleasure.
So at this time, I am going to turn it over to Susie. If anybody has questions, please go to the podium in the back with the microphone so that we can hear you and Mick can share his wisdom.
I'm going to have to try to be as witty as William F. Buckley. This is not going to be easy.
One, two.
Okay, first question from Tim Daly. Take it away, Tim.
Hi, Mick. Thank you for coming here.
It's my pleasure.
I really enjoy your Sunday Pink column.
Yes, thanks.
How much of that is because you enjoy the interaction? It seems like you have fun with it.
Oh, yeah, very much.
And what's the background on the whole Tom Cruise thing?
all the time. Well, no, that I knew. I said in my review, I said everybody likes Tom Cruise, including most of the people who pretend that they don't. And I thought that I'd get a lot of mail about that, but I didn't. And then I just got one email about it. So I mentioned, the person wrote to me, and then I mentioned that, you know, you're the only person who doesn't like Tom Cruise because it's been 3 weeks. And then I knew that that would provide the deluge. And so then that was fun, and it was good too, because I knew I wasn't reviewing any movies for that month, because the rule with the Ask Mick column for me has always been that it never goes dark, even if I'm on vacation. It always happens. Because I think it's, first of all, I like doing it, but also I think that it's nice for people to always know that something is going to be there. And so by having all these Tom Cruise letters, it made it easy, because I went away for a month and I was traveling and I wasn't reviewing any movies. So, and that usually is what provokes the responses. So it was just a nice source for about like 10 letters. I don't get as many letters as you would think. So, you know, if you want to send me any mail, you or any of you, please do. Because a lot of the mail that I get is unusable. Like, I really, you know, I like what you do. That was great what you did. I love when you said this. I can't print that because everybody would hate me. You know, you can't do that. But if I want people to like me, then I print the hate mail and then people feel like they have to defend me.
Good boy. I like that.
Yeah.
Okay. Next question.
Okay. Well, here's a double question.
Okay, newsroom. Double is good.
Okay, the newsroom.
Yes.
How far do you sit from Steve Rubenstein? Rubenstein?
I not enough to even know where he sits. Yeah, not
and
close
did,
enough.
Did you have lunch with Herb Cain before?
No, I didn't have lunch with Herb. I had very limited but pleasant contacts with Herb Cain. He was always nice to me. I remember one time I reviewed a movie called Modern Girls, and it was about being a young person in L.A. in the mid-80s. The movie was made then. It was 1986. And so I was like 27 when I reviewed it, and the people in the movie were my age, and I really liked the movie, and I think it actually is a very good movie. And I made some kind of remark. I bet everybody that they would like the movie. And then a few days later, I got a thing from Herb that says, you owe me $5. Because I did say that I bet your money you'll like this movie. Some turn of phrase. And so I had to give Herb $5 for this movie. But then I put it on my expense account, so it didn't make any difference.
And then the second question
okay.
is, you were mentioning Betty Davis in your and you asked Mick LaSalle.
Yeah, recently, yeah.
And about actors and artists are weird.
Yeah.
And which one is the most weird?
Oh, no, it depends. I mean,
it's just
an observation that very often what is really cool at any given point in history is right on the edge of being so weird it's ridiculous. And sometimes time passes and then we see it as ridiculous. Sometimes time passes and we don't. But, you know, it's like that. And you know, Betty Davis was pretty weird. You know, very, very, very big. You know, Prince was kind of weird. Bowie was kind of weird. You know, they go like about this far, and if they just go a little bit more, I would start laughing. So like cool is like this far from ridiculous. And I don't know why that is, but it very often is like that in the real popular arts. Yes.
You made a comment about, or there was a little bit of a discussion about the possible change in Best Picture for the Academy Awards.
Yeah.
And I thought they were going to add a category for blockbuster or
popular movie. Yeah.
And you don't think that's going to be a good thing?
I think they decided not to do that. Am I right?
Oh.
Yeah. They floated the idea. They float ideas publicly in order to see how people react. And I think that they wanted that because they wanted that popular category because a lot of good movies were beginning to win best picture, and they didn't like that because they want popular movies to be nominated, really, really, really popular movies. Yes?
Hi, I wanted to ask you about The Artist.
Yeah.
I believe it won Best Picture.
It did.
Right? I personally thought it was a very beautiful movie.
I thought
it was very cool that a silent film would win or be very popular in the 2010s. Were you surprised that it won and that it was as popular as it was, and did you think it deserved that?
By the time it happened, I wasn't surprised, you know, because it began to look like it might win, but I was very pleased. I love that movie. I thought it was just great. It was my favorite movie of the year. That was a rare case. My favorite movie of the year won Best Picture. That doesn't usually happen. I love that movie.
You have a lot of film lovers here. What film festivals would you recommend? I know you go to Venice every year.
Yeah, not every year, but every other year.
Because you like Italy or because you like the festival?
I guess it has to be a little bit of both. I like the time of year. The Venice Film Festival takes place usually the last day of August and the first 8 or 9 days of September, which is a great time to be in Venice, as opposed to like the Berlin Film Festival, which takes place in February in Berlin. It's freezing. I mean, it's just freezing. I only went once to Berlin for that reason. After that, I said, I just can't do it. Because what happens is it's so cold that if the movie's bad, you we'll wind up watching the whole movie anyway, because the idea of going back out is just too horrible. Whereas Venice, if you're watching a movie in 20 minutes, say, no, it's no good, I'm going to go back into Venice and enjoy myself. But what film festivals would I recommend? I haven't really been to too many, really. No, I really haven't. I've never been to Cannes. I'd like to go to Cannes. I've been to Berlin. Berlin's a great festival, but you have to really like the cold, and most people don't. I would highly recommend the Venice Film Festival because it gives you something interesting to do while you're in Venice. You know, so it's a place you might want to go anyway, but if you go there during film festival time, you'll wind up having, because you know how it is when you go to a place, and then once you get there, you sort of don't know what to do, because what you really want to do is have an experience of the place. But you don't know what happened. You know, people say to me, well, what should I do in San Francisco? I don't know. I mean, if you go to Fisherman's Wharf, I never go to Fisherman's Wharf. If they could go to museums, but very rarely is that part of my life. So it gives you something to do while you're in Venice, and I think it's a nice thing. And it's a, you know, generally, most of the time, the weather's really good at that time of year, and it's a, you know, very nice place.
So you haven't done Sundance or?
Well, Sundance is the same thing. I just don't like the cold. Ah. And Sundance is freezing, first off. And second, it's spread out. It's like if you go to Venice, all the buildings are, the farthest distance you'll have to walk is 10 minutes. But usually, it's like a two-minute walk from one theater to another. Sundance, you have to get on a bus. And the last time I went, and that was a while ago, though, they would have like breaks between movies. So you couldn't even just like say, okay, I'm just going to stay in this theater and watch all the movies. There'll be like an hour break. So it's freezing, and it's inconvenient. And also, too, it's all independent movies. And you know how it is with independent movies. Every so often, you see a good one. But most of the time, you don't. And instead, you just get these really ponderous movies with they all sound the same. They have the acoustic guitar soundtrack, the acoustic guitar in an echo chamber, bing, bing, bang, boing, and then the guy's walking along, you know, like a planes, and it's just, you know, it's pretty, most of those independent films are rough. So I wouldn't recommend that as for pleasure unless you go skiing, because then you have something else to do while you're watching movies. But I mean, you'll wind up seeing good things at Sundance, but it's just you'll have to blast for it. the way one does with independent films.
Hello, I have two comments.
Okay.
First, thank you for coming to Stockton.
Oh, it's great. It's really nice here.
Did you know that or remember that Audrey Cooper is from Stockton?
I was told. I didn't know Audrey was from Stockton. I'll have to tell her I was here.
Excellent reporter for the Stockton Record. Really excellent.
Wait, so she was an excellent reporter for the Stockton?
She was a reporter here.
And she was good?
Say again.
Was she good?
Oh, excellent.
Oh, very good.
she was so good that I think she got chastised by the publisher, but that's another story. I also wanted to thank you because I wrote to you 10 years ago and you answered. It was not for your pink column, it was just an email. Uh-huh. And I wanted to know if you had ever reviewed The Brothers Karamazov. And you said no one had ever asked you. So.
When was that even made? Was that with Yul Brynner?
It was in the 50s.
Oh, so it's a Yul Brynner movie?
But it had a good cast of characters like Lee Jacob, and even had William Shatner as a 20-year-old.
William Shatner is so
Thank
good.
Thank you.
William Shatner cracks me up. I love William Shatner. He has this acting, he's like a guy who's motivated by a spirit of generosity to go out in the street and start handing out counterfeit $100 bills. Do you know what I mean? It's like this, there's like this kind of crazy false exuberance. And like, if you want to imitate William Shatner, all you have to do is emphasize the wrong word in a sentence. Right? So if you just emphasize the wrong word in a sentence, you could sort of get halfway there. Yeah, I think he's great. And I think in a way, Alec Baldwin is sort of taking William Shatner's place culturally as a kind of guy who has a kind of cultivated a certain lovable egotism. Mm-hmm. I like both those guys. Yeah.
I have a question about rom-coms.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like ever since Nora Ephron died, like, and plus maybe that's just part of my generation, like this Sleepless in Seattle and, you know, like all those rom-coms that they've kind of, the rom-coms that come out today, sometimes I can just watch the trailer and I know the whole, you know, from the beginning to the end, you can kind of
give it away.
Piece it in. Do you feel like that there might be like a resurge, like from the festivals that you've been in, that like there's this new generation of women who want to like bring those back?
I like romantic comedies, and romantic comedies are an interesting genre because they tend to date poorly because sexual mores, because that's what they're about. They're about sexual mores and also like things that, like what's considered, not only what's considered acceptable, but also what's considered desirable. And these surprisingly change very quickly, like 10, 20 years pass and a romantic comedy looks different. Like for example, when I wrote Complicated Women, I was able to say that it was unheard of, even in a movie from the 90s. I wrote the book in 2000. No, I wrote the book in 1999. I said, even in the 90s, it's unheard of in a romantic comedy for a woman to have sex with a man purely for carnal reasons. In other words, she just likes the way he looks, so she goes to bed with him. Now that happens all the time in the last 18 years, especially in the last 10 years in romantic comedies. Mm-hmm. But so that's a convention that's changed. I don't know if we're going to be seeing a big resurgence of it, but I know that it's never going away. Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, romantic comedies are kind of like buddy films, the way buddy films are for friends. People have a great desire to see differences reconciled. They really want to see it. And a romantic comedy promises that that's going to happen. You know they're getting together. I mean, you know they're getting together. But you want to see how it happens because you want to believe in it. And so I don't think it's ever going away. I don't see a big resurgence, but it also depends on their being, because this is essentially it's something built around actresses. Mm-hmm. So you need the women for it. Mm-hmm. Jennifer Aniston is really good for that. Meg Ryan, also Sandra Bullock. They're all about 50 now. It's sort of out of the general range of romantic comedies. Although I wouldn't be surprised if Jennifer Aniston made another one. But Jennifer Aniston's like my favorite American actress in a way. I mean, I'll like to see anything Jennifer Aniston does. I think she's just really good. And I know that I may be partly influenced by the fact that I like the way she looks. I know that is an element. It has to be in an element. It's movies, you know. But I don't think I'm that influenced by it. I think she's really funny. And then when she has to do drama, she's really good too. I think she's just terrific. Mm-hmm. I think if she was a French actress, she'd be making great films. She'd be making great movies. Instead, she has to just deal with what she has to deal with. But every time she has a chance to do something a little bit different, she hits it out of the park. That's another thing. Mm-hmm. She's just terrific.
Because I was also, my husband and I, we saw The Big Sick in the movie theater.
Yeah.
And I thought it was really encouraging that it was a husband and wife team, and they both contributed to the script. So you had not just like one voice, that you had like both voices in that movie. And also that Amazon was the one that did that. So do you think that they're going to other, instead of like big, like MGM or Universal, now you have...
Now Amazon is, Amazon is already big. And Netflix is actually... Netflix is becoming a major factor. And they're doing the interesting thing of releasing movies simultaneously on Netflix and in theaters at the exact same time. The new Orson Welles movie. I stopped myself on the word new, but then I said, it's new because it was never completely edited. So it was just edited, the new Orson Welles film. And it's called The Other Side of the Wind, and it will be coming out on November 2nd. And I saw it already. I saw it in Venice, but that's getting simultaneously released on Netflix and in a few theaters.
And if you don't mind, too, I have another thing. You were talking about when people in the Oscars, they win the Best Actress or Best Actor Award, that sometimes they have to put, it's them being like a historical figure,
yeah,
or they have to put like on a lot of makeup and do something.
Yeah.
But with when Frances McDormand won for Three Billboards of Ebbing,
yeah, that was pretty good.
I felt like that she was almost like, there was a part of her that was like maybe coming out in that too. Like I felt like I was like watching her.
I know. I agree with you. I wonder what she was nominated against, because it's possible. Usually when a movie like that performance like that wins, it means that it's up against four other people who are playing themselves. Mm-hmm. But I'm not sure if that's true. No? Do you know? Sacramento film. Shape of Water, she's playing herself again, because she...
Lady Bird.
Yeah, she's playing herself, sort of. I mean, it's the way we think of her, as being just a young woman. It's not, she's not playing like, Chelsea Clinton, the Clinton years or something. Anything else? Then maybe that's why. Mm-hmm. Because nobody played a historical figure, yeah, or had a terrible illness or...
Because it seems like almost every role she plays, you see another part of her.
Which is what I like.
Yeah, like Moonrise Kingdom. I felt like I was watching her.
Yeah, and I have a prediction. Eventually, George Clooney will win Best Actor, and it'll be for the worst thing he ever did. Just like Al Pacino. Worst thing he ever did. Hoo-ha! It's terrible. It's terrible. But, Al Pacino was never bad in a movie other than in that movie. That's what they gave him the Oscar for.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
So we have time for about one more question.
All right. Here we go.
All right. First off, like others, thank you for coming to Stockton. This has been really quite wonderful.
Oh, yes.
Pleasure.
And thank you for your writing. We don't always agree, but I almost always enjoy your writing.
Oh, that's much better than agreeing. I like that better.
I have a much more abstract question, which I'm having a little bit of trouble formulating, but with which I've been struggling for some time. It deals with choices and sensibilities of black and white versus color.
Yeah.
And it may be that I am basically a child of the late 60s and following, that with a few exceptions, surrealism, dreamlike, et cetera, it strikes me that there's almost no movie that it wouldn't be better, to the extent that you're looking at trying to picture reality of some sort, like
yeah.
this room, in color.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So I'm wondering your opinion, your view, your understanding of how those choices are made, and
yeah.
why we still like black and white movies,
yeah.
as we seem to, somewhat rarely.
I don't know if this was in, because I was this, I don't know if, I was talking to Mike Fitzgerald. I don't know if he wrote about this, because I don't know, but did he write about the black and white thing?
No.
Okay, because we were just talking about that too. I personally didn't read the article, because it's just about me, and I'd rather just not read it, but maybe I'll read it later. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, because if it's nice, it's never nice enough, and if it's anything, if there's a slight thing in it I don't like, that'll be the only thing I think about. Okay, so since it wasn't in the paper, the black and white is like a dream, more than, and color is more like reality, and it depends what works. About 15 or 20 years ago, I saw a black and white photo of Britney Spears. And I was struck by, I thought she looked really beautiful and interesting. Now, Britney Spears is kind of beautiful, but she's never been interesting. Mm-hmm. But black and white made her look really interesting. And I think it was because there was something that we weren't getting. And so we wanted it. There's some thing we couldn't see or something, I don't know. And I think that a lot of the people from the classic era benefit from being photographed in black and white. I don't know, some of them might, we don't know, because, I mean, like Greta Garbo was never photographed in color. Mm-hmm. So I don't know what she would have looked like in color. Camille would seem like reasonable to be a color film, for example. I think it varies. I would not want Romeo and Juliet to be in black and white. That would just seem to be such a waste. But on the other hand, I would not want Citizen Kane or Casablanca to be in color, because that, I'd say that black and white has a certain romanticism. Hmm. And color has a kind of a vividness and beauty that's not necessarily romantic. I don't know. They each have their place. I'm glad that neither is completely, that, you know, that black and white has not completely disappeared, that you can still see it every so often. And I sort of wish that would have happened with silent film, that silent film would, you know, like maybe 1 out of 100 movies you see could still be silent. But unfortunately, that just went away. But I think there's a place for black and white. It's just, but I think it's also too is that our perceptions now are for color, so that black and white would look not just romantic, but a little bit artificial to us, and a little bit almost pretentious. Mm-hmm. Whereas, you know, if you're in 1950, it would just look normal.
Right, exactly.
So. Yeah.
One brief question, finally.
Yeah, sure.
Do you read other critics, and if so, is there someone you particularly like to read? Like, I like A.O. Scott, but I'm not a film critic.
There's no critics I really read. I mean, if I go to a city and I pick up the newspaper and it's a Friday, I'll look at the movie review. But there's no critics that I think Anne Hornaday is good. The only film critic that I ever really, I thought Andrew Saris is really good. I mean, he was like formative. It was great reading him when I was a teenager. But, you know, my favorite film critic to read, he's anthologized, is Otis Ferguson, who wrote for the New Republic in the 30s. And he was like the only guy killed on his boat in World War II. Because he happened to have a cup of coffee and a thing that got bombed by the Japanese at that moment when he was alone in the mess hall on a boat. But anyway, I thought he was a wonderful writer, and I like reading him. So if you ever have a chance to read Otis Ferguson, mm-hmm. read Otis Ferguson. He was kind of great.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Appreciate
so,
it.
And I want to thank you, Susan, for all your work and bringing Mick here. I want to thank the friends of the Stockton Library for making this possible, and I want to thank Mick.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Oh, this is great.
Awesome.
Great. Thank you.